Well, thank you for the organization of this wonderful meeting. So I'm very glad to be here and to see so many people interested in open science. As Eric said, so we co-founded with Celia Gruson-Daniel, who is also here and going to share this afternoon, an association 6 years ago. And 6 years ago, I was actually also exactly here defending my PhD at the ICM. So it's very funny because at that time, I was very proud to have published all my paper in open access and so on, but open science was not that much trendy as now. So it's very complicated to have a definitive definition of what open science is, and capturing this, it's out of my knowledge, but depending on what we have experienced through our association with AcurePhD, we tried not definitely to advocate a specific vision of open science, but more to raise debates, discussion, and actually feed this mind jazz around what would make science open. My tackle would be more about knowledge as a common, but I put it more as a question and to leave the definition open. So, well, when you discuss with people about knowledge and how to make it open and collaborative and so on, some stuff that are connected to open science, the first idea that come to people are not connected to science itself, but more like Wikipedia and the encyclopedia, in line with the dream of D'Alembert and Diderot, but at worldwide level and leveraging technological tools. Now we have the opportunity to collaboratively write our sum of knowledge in a very robust and dynamic way. But beyond this society of information, society of knowledge, what also is sometimes left behind is wisdom and how we put our value in those tools and endeavor. And so, for instance, one thing about opening science is also a reaction to maybe a state of affair with academia and people who are not really happy about how science is made. And actually, during my postdoc, it was very funny because we were starting this AcurePhD stuff, and my postdoc advisor was like, but why trying to open science? I mean, science is open by default. I mean, it's not like, it's a tautology. And so maybe it's because of this kind of situation where people are not at all happy anymore with what science has become as a research more than a scientific thing. And behind this word, there's also the second thing that people have in mind when you talk about open science is open source. And open source is a good example to introduce the complexity of those thing, because even in open source software, there is a whole gradient of approach. And I put like three people also to introduce the gender imbalance in science and gender imbalance in the computer software. So this is like, who is this? So it's not working, but never mind. So on the left is Bob Young. The nudge is that he has a Red Hat, so he's the creator of Red Hat. Red Hat is a distribution from Linux. And so this person made a business out of open source. Basically for him, open source was a business opportunity. On the right, you have Richard Stallman, creator of the GNU and General Public License, and founder of the Free Software Foundation, and someone who has a very strong ideological approach to open source as a way also to connect freedom of speech and freedom of use with technology. And in the middle, you have a balance, Linus Torvald, creator of Linux, who has a very pragmatic approach of open source. Basically for him, it's the best way of writing software. And open science may be also connected to this world gradient of values, approach, and motivation. So behind this open source initiative, the logo of open science that have been then motivated afterwards as a use is kind of connected to this open source stuff. And there is, if we try to make basic polarization of topics, three main maybe topics that stand out. First, like the knowledge, the education, the research, and how we have actually as human endeavor to make this knowledge collectively. And so like the second pole is openness and collaboration and sharing of this knowledge. And the third one, which is kind of connected to also this movement of open science, is technology, internet, and all the digital practices that kind of disrupt traditional way of generating this knowledge. And so on top of all this generation of knowledge and the way to transmit it, we have also seen in the recent years a move to open course and MOOC, like massive open online courses, and how also opening knowledge is to make it more accessible to others. I will come back later with open washing, why this thing has not been fulfilled really. But opening knowledge necessitates also to people to not have a paywall each time they want to access a paper. And a big, the forefront, I would say, of people who really changed the thing in open science were the people from open access. And people like the Public Library of Science, like PLOS, or the Center for Open Science in Charlottesville, those people created a real movement with a very legitimate message, which is like, knowledge not be paid twice, one by tax money payer and one by tax money payer twice. So research papers should be free to access. And it's not only like in the Richard Stallman view of open source, it's not like free like in free beer, it's more like free like in free speech and freedom. And so it's not about just accessibility of the content, but also the ability to reuse it, to change it, and to remix it. And on the side of this, I would say, classical open access, we have seen also people like Aaron Schwartz, who sadly died, and now we have Alexander Albakian, who is another very interesting personality of movement of opening knowledge at all price, and even in an illegal way, because it's a legitimate fight, like in the citizen declaration, like when it's needed, then you can go against law. Connected to this open access thing, something that was completely obvious for physicists, but it took years to biologists and psychologists to get there, is preprint. And while people were putting preprint on archive and considering totally normal that basically putting their work and their draft on internet and have feedback before submitting to journal, and now it's even even more interesting, like some disciplines have removed journals and only use preprint, so it's interesting to think. There's a huge burst of number of preprint in the last decade. So from 2012 to 2018, especially in bioarchive, that has been a huge success. Another aspect which is tricky is the data. So you can open papers, you can have them accessible to the public, but we were discussing last night about, well, some people like to have their specific brain area or specific gene in the paper, and they're happy if the figures show it. But a lot of people now are computationally oriented and they want to have the figure and the table in a CSV format in a computationally processable way. And opening knowledge is also now opening data. And opening data is not putting all your data on a FTP server and let people just deal with that. It's also metadata, making it and interoperable and accessible. We're gonna have people who are gonna speak, for instance, of FAIR data concepts. And so behind this trendy big data, there is the open data looming, and upon that there is also the GDPR looming. So like how to regulate all that, and how challenges are very important to make the balance between openness, transparency, but also privacy and respect of people rights. And finally, like another aspect that is more political is the citizen science, and how open science also to opening academia and its ivory tower to the citizens, not only as a only one-way outreach, like where academics come to the world and say this is the truth, but more where citizens are active. So for instance, we're going to have example of patient association, where like patients are the most concerned by their pathology, and they are also the most first person informed about what's going on with their disease. So there are many ways of including citizens in the process of science, and in the current society with some people call post-factual society, or with all the fake news, this is also important at the political level to make citizens collaborating with science to also raise critical thinking and sensibilize people to the scientific methodology. And so there are examples that go beyond open science on that, and especially like examples, for instance, like Icelandic with the writing collectively of constitution. And so there is indeed, it's not like there is clear boundaries of where open science is and where it can percolate in society. So I have used almost 1,000 times open in the world presentation, and the problem with open science and so on, it has indeed, compared to 6 years ago, it has become totally mainstream, and people are using open at all the different flavor you can think of. And so there is something that people should keep in mind, which is like in the same way as ecology has been recaptured by open greenwashing, there is also a form of open washing. And so I would say that during these 2 days, to raise your critical thinking and see what really mean open for you, what is the value behind that. And so I give 4 examples. For instance, the case of open access, the dark side of open access is the bill list of predatory publishing. So a lot of people are spammed with people asking them, do you want to candidate for the International Journal of whatsoever thing and pay $10,000 and you're gonna be published anyway. Maybe we won't see anything afterwards, but so this predatory publishing has kind of surf on this open access trend to make money out of it and to basically recapture the interest made on open access. Then one thing that is very important is the precariousness of academia and how open science should not be a even more precarity for researchers. So like, I don't know if you're familiar with Kaggle and those data science challenges. It's a way of having 5,000 people working on your problem and pay only 3 of them. Opening science should not be at the price of making academics and students even more precarious. And well, then you have the difference between discourse and practice. I talked about the open data. It's not just putting your data on a FTP server. In the case of MOOC, for instance, it's funny to see that now you can start to see MOOC that are paid. Like you have to pay to access the MOOC, while MOOC initially was for open, so that you should not be paying for MOOC. But anyway, people are, Celia has worked a lot on this topic, and it's kind of a good example on the gap between discourse and this openness in appearance and in practice. So also a big issue with open science was the business model behind it. I'm a very idealistic person, but in the last years I realized that being idealistic in our world is not that productive if you don't have in mind the financial constraint. So how you make this thing work financially. And this is a big topic. I mean, to not contaminate values that you want to have in your practice as open scientist while still making it sustainable financially is a big challenge. And I hope we're going to have discussion about how to make it happen. Maybe open source is a good community to relate to because they have more years behind on these questions. And so, like, I mean, Richard Stallman is not Bill Gates and Lynn Stovall either. Well, maybe Bob Young is richer, but they all made their path according to their values, so it's possible to find it. And finally, to go back to this state of affair with behind open science, maybe it was also a kind of reaction of new scientists who were not really happy of what they have been told about science. And when they come in academia, they realize that it's not that unicorn and fairy tale. It's how we can empower people to make those value percolate within academia and within society. And the challenge is big because the power structure and the incentives are really there, and scientists are super conservative compared to what we can think. So there are like different scales of action from your local lab to the macro system and advocacy and lobbying, etc. But so maybe a big challenge to go beyond this openness and to have this in mind from value point of view, like moving to a social value, to collective achievement, and not stay to the idea of open science as being like a brand or just a tick to have in your grant to be accepted by the European Commission, but more like something that you situated in the community and society. So thank you very much. I didn't spoke about AcurePG much, so Celia and myself, who are co-founding the association, are there today, so I invite you to come to us if you are interested to know more about it. But, well, it's not indeed unicorn and fairy tale. It's not easy to opening your practices, a lot of work sometimes. But, well, that's where magic happens also. So I encourage you to make the jump. Thank you very much.